morning, church at Glass Chapel. It's good to see you today. Are you happy to be in church today? Not in jail? Isn't it good to be here? Not in jail, right? Amen. You know, decisions determine direction, and direction determines your destiny. So the decisions you make in life affect not only you, but they affect the people around you. Amen. And one of the greatest things we can do is have a servant's heart. So we're continuing on with that series, and my wife and I, Pastor Judy Joe, are going to do this today together. Well, I really love to teach with her. She's an amazing, you know, when she speaks, she doesn't just speak from, you know, just from, you know, stuff she studied. She speaks from a heart of experience and love, and she is the most amazing woman of God I've ever met. So listen well. Amen. Philippians chapter 2, the way up is down, loving is serving. That's what we're talking about. Is that right? If we want to be great, then what do? In the kingdom, we serve, right? But really, to have the right heart, you don't ever care if you're great. I don't care if I'm great. I want to be great for you when I preach. I want to be great for you as a pastor. But when I look at you, Paul said, esteem others better than yourself. When are we going to get a hold of that? Unselfishness and the love of God, serving one another. It's not about me getting one up on you. Even when you tell jokes, we try to get one up on each other. We're always trying to get one up on somebody. Let the other guy get one up on you. Humble yourself. Amen. Humility is so powerful, it can change everything in your life. Love is powerful. Listen to Philippians 2, 5 through 9. In the Passion Translation, they took it off of Bible Gateway, but I love this translation. Why? Because it's more like, I don't know, it just brings out a lot of things you might not see. It's more like a paraphrase Bible, I guess. But listen to this. And consider the example that Jesus, the Anointed One, has set before us. Let His mindset become your motivation. Now, what was Jesus' mindset? What does that mean? That was His way of thinking, a process. You have to renew your mind, Romans 12, with the Word of God. Is that right? Is that true? Paul beseeched you to renew your mind. I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. But he also said that we need to renew our minds with the Word of God, right? So if we're always in a take attitude, even governments try to get it to where we always take. We should be givers. Don't let the mindset of take dominate your heart and mind. Let the mindset of Christ dominate your heart and mind. What did He live for? To serve the people. I live to serve you. Decisions determine direction. The direction determines your destiny. The day I decided to get in my car with $500, $600 and leave my family in Georgia and drive to Broken Arrow, Oklahoma, where I didn't know but one man and a woman and another preacher, but I didn't know him. They knew him. And I drove to Broken Arrow in an old Mitsubishi Priusus. When they first came out, it was the worst car in the world. I barely made it, right? But, you know, you get here. You know how I was greeted in Broken Arrow? There was an ice storm when I got here. And I slid off the road the first day here. And I had to have a wrecker come. There went a couple hundred bucks, right? I only had four left. You know what? But that decision, without sacrifice, there is no life. The seed must die. When will you let go? You are a seed. When will you let go of you and let Christ live through you? When do we let go of what we want? When do we allow the seed to die truly? Well, I die with Christ, brother. I believe in Christ's realities. Well, I do too. But when do we live it? Jesus said, unless a kernel of corn or wheat or a seed falls to the ground and dies, it remains alone. But we try to hold on to what we want. Myself. I want this. This is what I want with my life. I know God wants me to do this. Have I ever disobeyed God? Ask me that. Go ahead. Go to ask me. Oh, yeah. I've disobeyed God. You know what? It almost killed me more than one time. I've disobeyed God several times, just like you have. I'm human. But you know what? It almost cost me my life. Almost cost me my life. Even recently, the Lord showed me not to do something one day, and I did it and had a three-car pileup, almost killed somebody. I did, because I disobeyed what God showed me to do that day. See, God will save you from situations. He will save you from bad relationships. But I'm so lonely, so I went to the bar that night. Oh, yeah. How's that going to work out? Misery. You know what hangs out in those bars? A lot of bad things and bad people. No, they're not bad people in themselves, but what they fellowship with is bad. The spirits, the evil. Why? Because what's up there is trying to suck you in to destroy you. We come here to fill up on God, life, His Spirit. The bar is there to fill you up with darkness. It's a church. Do you understand me? But it's not called a church. Okay, we won't talk about that anymore, but somebody must have needed to hear that. If you play with fire, you're going to get burned. Sin does not play, sin kills. Period. It's like cyanide. Do you want to put a little bit on your tongue and lick it? You want to lick that cyanide? You do. Sometimes people do. They lick the lollipop, and guess what? It brings death. It brings divorce. It brings selfishness. It brings pain. But in Him is life, joy. Peace. Listen, our marriage hasn't been perfect, but let me tell you what. For the most part of our marriage, we've been extremely happy because we love each other. We've learned to walk in a place of serving one another. Did you hear that? Serving each other in humility in our marriage. All of us need to hear a little bit more of that. In our marriage, serve one another and have humility. It says, Jesus existed in the form of God, yet He gave no thought to seizing equality with God as His supreme prize. So, very interesting thought here. We talk a lot about what God's done for us. Jesus could have declared Himself king when He stepped foot on, when He, at 30 years old, He said, I'm the king. I'm the king of kings. But He said, no, I'm your servant. Do you get it? Here we go. We talk big. But when's the last time you said, Lord, I'm a servant? Jesus had the crown on His head. He left heaven, left everything to be a servant for you, even to the point of dying like a murderer on a cross. That was for criminals. He served you to the point of very death when He could have lived like a king. Now, do you understand what I'm saying? We need to believe we can do all things through Christ. We need to believe that greater is He that's in us than he that's in the world. I can do all things through Christ. But do you look at the other side of the coin that says, I am a servant. I'm a slave of Christ. And I'm a servant to the people. I am here. Why am I here? The only reason God sent me here was for you. I am here to serve you. Amen. Go ahead, honey.
Amen. So not only did Jesus make Himself nothing for us, but I love this aspect that Jesus served the whole person. So we sat down together. We often sit on our back porch, and we sat on the swings, and we're like, let's talk about Jesus the servant. Let's share, because we always think about Jesus the teacher and what He did, or Jesus the miracle worker. But now let's take a minute. Let's talk about how He served His people. Amen? And I love that. Let's first look at Matthew 15. In Matthew 15, it talks about the feeding of the 4,000. Before that, Matthew 14 was the feeding of the 5,000. In Matthew 15, we see the feeding of the 4,000. He was giving the word, taking His time, pouring out the word. And wait a second, everything stops. And all of a sudden, He's concerned about the people. And in verse 32, Jesus called His disciples to Him and said, I have compassion for these people, for they've already been with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. I don't want to send them away hungry, or they may collapse along the way. Now, this is perfect for me, because if you know me, you know I love to feed people. There's a lot of people in this room I've probably fed. Feeding people is, you know, this love language of how you receive and how you give. I give by feeding people. That's what I do. I feed people. So I'm really connected to this method of the way Jesus served. And so what does He say? He says, I have compassion on them. What did He want to do? He wanted to meet their physical need. He wasn't just giving out the word. And it'd be nice as ministers if we could just sit and just give out the word. But it was so much more than that. Yeah. As much as we saw Him give the word, we saw Him get on His knees. And we saw Him care for the people that God had assigned Him to. Amen. He cared for their physical needs. How many in here have ever been hungry? Yeah? I've been hungry. We've been hungry in different countries where we were hungry because we couldn't eat the food or we'd get sick. And yeah, there was food there, but you couldn't eat it. And so you're hungry. And hunger pains can be a real thing. You should see this man when he gets hungry around midnight. That's all I'm going to say about that. Hunger is a real thing.
You hear the door open quick.
Fast.
I'm in the kitchen in
his
a bag.
His feet are moving fast, and he's got to have food. People would do anything to get food, and we carry the ability to meet that need. Are you with me? People would do anything to have their physical needs met, and you and I carry the ability to meet the needs of people. Okay, now let's look at 1 John. 1 John 3:17. I'm going to read it in the Message Bible. Okay, I'm just going to be honest. This kind of blew me away. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
This is how we've come to understand and experience love. Did you get that? This is how we come to truly experience and understand love. Christ sacrificed his life for us. This is why we ought to live sacrificially for our fellow believers and not just be out for ourselves. If you see a brother or sister in need and have the means to do something about it, but turn a cold shoulder and do nothing, what happens to God's love? It disappears. And you made it disappear. I didn't say that that was the word. And we made it disappear. You see, we have the ability to give this love or to not give it. And often we think we understand love by how we've received it, right? But I'm telling you, it's much deeper than that. Just like the way up is down, and this message is about opposites. We think we've known love when someone's loved us well. No, my friend, you've not really known love until you've given it well, because it goes to this deep place that surpasses what anyone could ever give you. And when you think about Christ on the cross and what he did, was he gave love. And in giving love, we experience the deepest tone of love that mankind can experience. It's not as we receive it. It is as
Amen.
We give it.
So good.
Human nature thinks it's receiving love, but it's deepest known when we give it away. And we carry that ability to give it. And life wants to try to make us selfish because of all we've been through. And I just wish someone would love me, and I just wish someone would care for me. And listen, we do. But I'm telling you, if you really want to know love, if you really want to get out of your down place, if you really want to live large, we've got to come to this place where we don't turn a shoulder to the needs of mankind, but we dig deep and we give that same love away. Go
Amen.
Ahead.
Amen. Wow, that's good. You're shaking me up, honey, just like the day, first day I met you. Woo-wee. She shook me up, man. She shook me up. Amen. Praise God. Verse 7 in Philippians 2. I want to continue. I kind of got to going ahead of myself. But instead, Jesus emptied himself. I know we've been born again. We've received the fullness of the Holy Spirit. We're walking by faith. But at the same time, you must empty yourself of you in a sense of what you want in your life. You will have wants and desires, but I want to be close to him so that truly happens what David said, delight yourself in the Lord. Delight. Did you delight in him this week once? Did you take delight in the Father? I'm challenging you. I told you, if you step foot in these doors, you will be challenged. I don't care if you've been in the ministry 95,000 years or one day or you just got saved. Amen? It's all about that. Emptying ourselves of what we want, unless the seed dies. When you truly lay your life on that altar and you say, everything I have is yours. Everything. Yes, it includes money, but that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about your obedience. Are we obedient? What? Firstly, every day, what does he want? He wants you. He wants you. He wants to spend time with you, just like he did with Adam. And let me tell you what, that's what made this man the man he stands before you now. That's what made me who I am, was my desire to know God, not to be great. I'm sick of preachers trying to be great and act like they're great. I don't mean that bad. I love preachers. I'm a preacher, right? I can criticize preachers because I'm one. No more pomp. No more display. Let's be real. Let's love the people. Let's treat the people with respect and dignity like they deserve, because that's who Jesus died for, sitting right in that pew. And I'm willing to lay down my life for you, just like Jesus said he was willing to lay down his life, and he did it. And I'm willing to lay down my life for you. And that's where preachers need to be these days. We need to get off that high horse and get down with the people and walk with them and talk with them and be with them and relate with the people. I'm talking to preachers. Hopefully if you're listening right now, somewhere in the world, right? Well, I'm talking to all of us. Empty ourselves. I've seen it. I've seen the pomp in ministry. The air, the put on, the fanciness. That doesn't mean anything to me anymore. I hate it. You know what I love? I love the people. That's what it's all about. It's about you. It's not about the fancy stuff we drive, the fancy houses. God doesn't really give a lick about that. And if you think he does, then you don't know him that well. And I said it boldly. You need to get to know him a little better. Because he paves his streets with what you think so fancy around your neck and on your hand and the diamonds. He makes gates out of pearls so big that one of them would buy America. Okay, I'll rest my case. Instead, he emptied himself of his outward glory by reducing himself to the form of a lowly servant. He became human. Jesus, come on! Let this sink in. Let it strike you deep. Let it be like when a baseball player hits a sweet spot and he doesn't just hit a home run, but a grand slam, man. He humbled himself and he became vulnerable, choosing to be revealed as a man and was obedient. He was our perfect example, even in his death, the criminal's death by crucifixion. Because of his obedience, God exalted him. When you try to exalt yourself in the kingdom, you will be brought low. But when you humble yourself, you will be raised up. It's the opposite of the world system. Everybody say it's the opposite of the world system. What is a servant? A servant is a helper, a minister, one who serves another. A helper. Who wants to be called a helper? When I first moved here, I got a job driving a trash truck. Trash truck, man. It was a roofing company, Park Allwine, one of the best guys in the world. Used to work for Allwine Roofing. Chuck and Donna Dittemore, good to see you guys, part of our family. Yeah, I'm back on Doug. I know, I had to say hey to those guys. So, what was on? Just kidding. But when I was a roofer, I mean, it was hard work. And I remember one time, I was on the roof and I was on the peak, and it snowed. It was about that much ice and snow. And I decided I was going to get on my snow shovel, and I was going to have a little fun. And I was going to slide 5 feet and stop. But, that was when I got promoted to be on the crew. Then I got a foreman job, you know. But are we willing to drive the trash truck? The most humble is the most powerful. You know what I notice when I'm around people? Not how much they talk about, how much they know about the Bible around me. Actually, kind of turns me off when people try to preach to me all the time. You know what turns me on? Humility. You know what turns God on? Soft, humble heart. Not a man all crusty with pride. Keep that pride out, man. That pride comes before a fall. I'm telling you, men, I've taken some licks because of my pride. You don't like it. It's no fun. It's not worth it. In the roofing story, so I slid down the roof 4 feet, but by the time I got 4 feet, my feet went right up. It was like a big snow shovel. I was like, went into mock turbo speed, man. In a half second, actually it was four inches, it went down like so fast, and then I'm like off the roof in the snow. The other guy that was with me, he looked at me and he went, man, Russ, you're crazy, man. But the point was, I wasn't trying to go off the roof. I was just trying to have fun. The way up is down, get it? Ha, ha, ha. You had to climb back up that ladder, right? A servant has a low, let me give you a few statements here that you can write down or remember, all right? A servant has a low attitude of oneself compared to other people. Now, I know greater seat. Now, listen, I know in Christ realities. But if you don't know the other side of that coin, and when I try to teach some people this, they resist it. They resist it. It's pride. Don't resist this teaching. You know what I'm saying? Who wants to resist the teaching on humility? If all you do is focus on in Christ and never on the humility side, you're going to walk around like a cocky little chicken. Look how great I am. Greater is he that's in me. I can do anything. Everybody get in my way. I'm going to win the world. Well, great. I love that. I love it. That's how I was. I was that way. And I did a lot of things, but I loved people. It's all about heart. It's all about attitude. When you walk in a room, you can lift everybody's spirits. When you walk in a room, you can make everybody happier. Just with a smile. The smallest things touch people's lives. Amen? Man, I'm trying to stay on my notes today, guys. Goodness. A servant considers nothing of his own to be his own. Everything we have is truly God's. Amen? A servant is humble, having a spirit of deference. That means you defer to other people instead of always getting your way. Selfishness in a marriage is your greatest enemy. Hello. Selfishness in your marriage. I want what I want, and I want it now. What if she has a headache? Maybe you better be compassionate. You know what I'm saying? Or what if something else is going on? You got to be compassionate to the person on the other side. A servant is humble. Ranking low in hierarchy or scale when it comes to others, we truly need to maintain a servant's heart. The next thought, a servant does not mind doing the small things. Be small in your own mind or eyes when comparing yourself to other people. Now listen, I speak God's word when I wake up and through the day. Greater is he that's in me. I can do all things. But I also remind myself that I am your servant, that I'm a humble servant to you. And what's that do? That keeps the leader where he should be in his heart and mind. It's easy in leadership to get proud. Have you ever heard anybody say that? Leaders don't like to admit it. But it's true. You have to really guard your heart. Did not a great wise man once tell us that? Guard your heart with all diligence. What's God concerned about? Your heart. Where is it today? Where's your heart today? Where is your heart today? Amen. Wake up hungry for God every day. 1 Samuel 15:17 says, so Samuel said. Samuel the prophet spoke to King Saul when he rebelled against the Lord God. When you were little, say this back with me. When you were little, in your own eyes, were you not the head of the tribes of Israel? When you are not little in your own eyes, humility to God is great. Isn't it interesting to me? God allows us to think about ourselves the way we want to think about ourselves, and what you feel your mind is and what you want to think about yourself, you can. How many people want to meditate on humility? I'll tell you what, without that humility, you will never fulfill everything God has called you to do in this life. We talk about faith a lot, don't we? But what about a humble heart? Why? Because pride comes before a fall. How many want to fall down, bust your knees, your face? Definition of humble is not proud, not thinking of yourself as better than other people. Given or said in a way that shows you think you are better than other people, not selfish. That you are not better than other people and not selfish. Now listen to that wording. Given or said. What's that? Words and actions. When I get around people, I listen for humility because it's a leadership trait I want to have in the leadership staff. When I get around people, I listen for people who aren't trying to show off, but trying to just be who God called them to be. As a leader, you learn to sift through all kinds of things. Wow, what does God look for? The eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth, looking to show him strong on behalf of those whose heart is upright before him. David, the king, would never have been king had he not been a man after God's own heart. I stand up here, not as a perfect man, but as a man who has loved God and loved my family. Quote, then I'm going to turn it over to my wife. Martin Luther King Jr. said this, life's most persistent and urgent question is this, what are you doing for other people? Charles Dickens, no one is useless in this world who lightens the burdens of other people. John Holmes said this, there is no exercise better for the heart than reaching down and lifting people up. How many want to lift people up? Let me say this, when I lift you up, I'm lifting me up. When you lift a person in this church up, you're lifting yourself up, because God will make sure you get will return to you what you've done for other people, because Jesus said, whatever you've done for the least of these, you've done it for me. How many of you are reaching out to Jesus every day, if you know what I mean? Amen, by serving people. Go ahead, babe.
I feel like we could stay on that one, the aspect of Jesus as a servant by being humble. We could just park our car there today, couldn't we? You know, yes. It says that we humble ourselves in the sight of the Lord. Who humbles us? Is it your spouse, your friend, your employer's job to humble you? We humble ourselves, but we don't want to do that. But I'm telling you, there's such victory in it. There's such life in it. There's such experience of love that I talked about before in it, as we do what he just preached us, and that's humble ourselves. So here's another aspect for you. Jesus was touchable. He served with his time. Now, we've built this kind of thing, you know, Russ and I have traveled the world where you don't see it, and then you come back here where you see it, and you just come to hate it. This thing we've built of this untouchable, impregnable minister in the pulpit, and I honestly hate it, because it's nothing, it's really, I shouldn't say that. No, I'm going to say it.
Say it.
It's very comparable to why Lucifer fell. Because he tried to exalt himself above Christ, because he loved the feeling of being puffed up, mm-hmm. right? And your flesh and my flesh wants to be puffed. It does. Trust me. We want to be puffed up. But that's not the way of the kingdom. The way of the kingdom is to humble ourselves. Is that right?
Mm-hmm. Very good.
Anyway, Jesus we see as a touchable man. And I don't see any way we can love people without being accessible and without being touchable. I don't care how big your church is. If I can't shake your hand, if I can't touch and feel you, how can I be bigger than Jesus? I don't think I can be. And I know, I get some of the aspects, I know, but I'm just saying the Jesus you love and the Jesus I love was a touchable Jesus. He walked with man. He didn't just walk with them. He took time to see them, to eat with them. We've got this story of Zacchaeus in Luke 19. If I was a singer, I'd sing you the Zacchaeus song, but we all know I'm not. So I'm not singing it for you, but you know where Zacchaeus was. Wait, that's it. Where was he?
Tree.
What kind of tree? Yes, you all got the song now, right? It's ringing inside of you. No, he was not hunting. Oh, okay. That's what Russ does in trees. No, Zacchaeus was trying to... He was trying to see Jesus, right? That's why he had went up this tree. And so Jesus comes by. And who was Zacchaeus? He was a chief, not just a tax collector. He was big dog. He's big dog tax collector, right?
IRS, yeah.
He's the IRS. The IRS is in the tree.
We're just having fun.
Just having fun.
Just having fun.
Waiting for Jesus to pass by. And what does Jesus do? Listen, he's Jesus.
Yeah.
He could have, in his pomp and robe, walked on by. But no, what does he do? He sees Zacchaeus in the tree, because Jesus always took time to see people, right? And he sees Zacchaeus in the tree. Why is Zacchaeus in the tree? It says he was short. Anybody else understand what it's like to be short? I live with three tall men. Okay, two of them are my sons, in case you don't know our family, just to qualify all that. They're tall. They're tall, and so often they're not where I need them to be, and so I get a ladder, and all the time I hear, be careful on that ladder. Just a short thing I thought I'd throw in, since that's the reason Jesus was in the tree. So Jesus is in the
Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was in the tree.
Zacchaeus is in the tree. Jesus passes by. He sees Zacchaeus in the tree. He says, Zacchaeus, come down. I'm going to your house. What? a tax collector? Yes. He was going to his house with him that day to eat. And I love what goes on here. Two things. He sees him and he goes to his house. The vision of this church is you, your circle, your world. I want you to be the one seen. I want your gift to be used. I want you to find who you are. That's our passion for you in this church, is that we see you, because God sees you and he cares about that gift, and he wants to take that gift and pull it out and develop it, amen, so that you can be all you're supposed to be for the kingdom. So he sees you, and our passion is to see you. But not only that, he went to his house. Yeah. In Luke 10, he was touchable. In Luke 10, we see the story of the Good Samaritan that I love, and it's very long. I'm just going to read a piece of it. A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. Oh, no. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Then we know what happens. A priest goes by, does nothing. A Levite goes by, does nothing. But then comes this Samaritan, who, if any of you studied that out, he shouldn't have been associating with them, right? But this good Samaritan, as he came by, saw him. What did he do? He saw him, and then he chose to take pity on him. He went to him, bandaged his wounds, pouring in the oil and the wine. He took time to see this man that was beaten up. There's so much I could say right now. So much I could say. I can remember Russ and I, our first trip to India, we were newlyweds, and I'll never forget the gravity of... It kind of goes back to the first scripture I shared of experiencing the love of Christ and thinking you're loved when you give it, but instead you're loved when you get it. Instead you're loved when you give it. And I always say India gave more to me than I ever gave to it, because it taught me about what love really was. And I can remember these children that they'd be mangled is the best way I know to put it, and laid at bridges. I'm like, how did this child get mangled? Because the parents break their bones and let them heal back wrong so they can set them on these bridges and beg. And my mind is seeing this. I'm saying, I can't take this. I can't see this. And you go into this mode of protecting your heart. And how many of us have done the same thing? In order to make it through this life, our heart, listen to me. There's some of us in here and our hearts have become hard because of what we've been through in life. And in doing so, we no longer see man and we no longer see people, and we can't have compassion on them because we've had to guard our heart. But this good Samaritan saw the beat up man. No matter what he'd been through in his life, no matter his situation, I'm purposed in my life. And I have to call myself back to it often. No matter what I've been through, we've seen rough stuff, as rough as it gets, all around the world, right? Chip and Kathy know. We've seen rough stuff. And you see that rough stuff, and it wants to make you this hard-hearted person. That's why we can't judge people. You don't know what... Listen, I don't know why I'm off on all this. You can't judge the person that hurt you. You don't know where their heart is and what they've been through. You don't know what allowed them to become like that, that caused the reaction that you didn't want. Our job is to guard our heart. Our job is to keep our heart humble. No matter what we've been through, we got to take this heart and we got to guard it so that we see people and so that we can be the love of God in action all the time. Amen. Glory to God. Okay, so he takes care of this man who is beat up, and he pours in the oil and the wine, and he saw him.
Yeah.
And yet
he touched him.
A priest went by and a Levite went by. Mm.
Spiritual people.
But he took time to touch him. Mm. And Jesus took time to touch us. Mm. And he'll take time to touch you every day. And he calls us to do the same thing. He wants to be touchable. And so Jesus goes into Zacchaeus' house. A tax collector? You see, there's something about serving. Serving is, we serve with our time, not just our money. Mm. Not just the meal I cook somebody. We serve with our time. When I take time to see you in your need and go to you and talk to you, I'm serving you. I'm being touchable. And my time is probably the most valuable thing we have to give. Amen? So one beautiful way we serve is with our time. Listen, yes, have healthy boundaries. But listen, don't wall yourself from the gift of serving others. Don't let those boundaries become a brick wall that was never intended to be there. Amen. We have to continue to see people. Part of serving is being present. Jesus was present with his people.
That's good stuff. How many of you actually woke up one day last week and said, I don't want to be successful in life? Anybody this month, this year? Have you ever woken up in life and said, I don't want to be successful? I'm just interjecting a side thought. True success in the kingdom, there must be training. We think that, you know, you go to college to get a great job, right? But you've been in school for what? Since you were 5 till you're 22. How many years is that? 17 years, is that right? And then we expect to be successful in the kingdom by reading a Bible verse a day? Come on, I want to make it reality to you right now. We go to school for 17 years to be a success in the natural, but yet in the kingdom we just take it nonchalant. No, success is through training. Well, that's why I think everybody should go to Bible college. I'm not going to pressure you. You're not going to get pressure, but we need God's word in us to renew our minds and feed our heart. Every day we must feed our hearts his word. But I tell our students around the world, I said, never stop training. Because when you stop training, you're stopping leading. When you stop training, you stop leading. Or at least your desire to lead. Because any great leader wants to always improve himself, even on the musical instruments. Is that right? Never get complacent with your gifting. Improve it. Increase it. Because we will stand before the judgment seat of Christ, my friend. All of us Christians will. I was out at Spring Creek and almost got stuck out there. I had a tire problem. You don't want to have a tire problem out in the middle of the boondocks in Oklahoma. So I had to find a tire shop. So I'm out hunting a tire shop. I look like a real Okie. I look like a real hillbilly too, man. I have my shorts on. I'm all dirty. Went at the creek, have my tank top on. I've been praying, spending time with the Lord, and the tire's down to like 17. And I saw that, and I'm like, I got to get to a place now. So I went to Moody. Stopped by this lady's house, ended up going to Moody. Well, there was the lady told me at the gas station, there's a tire shop down the street right there. Just go up there. So I went down to the tire shop, got the tire shop. This Okie, I'm an Okie, all right? Just not making fun. I mean, I'm an Okie, and I was all Okied out, man. He was Okied out too, no shirt, hairier than a grizzly bear, man. Buff dude walks out about 28 years old. I mean, this guy looked like he'd been bodybuilding, but you could tell he was just a natural. You know, I used to do a little bit of bodybuilding. This guy was a natural, right? He was just walks out buffed up, hair all messed up, dark hair, you know, greasy and everything. And my grandpa was a mechanic. I'm used to grease. So I walk in there and I talk to him and he helps me out. And the Lord put it on my heart. Go to the gas station, get him some money and bless this guy. And, man, I went to that gas station, got 40 bucks. Paid 20 bucks to get 40 bucks, you know what I mean? The ATMs, I'm like, and I hate to do that, but God put it in my heart. You bless this man. You minister to this man. But it's not in my schedule, God. I'm out here praying. And then God, imagine God sending you to reach somebody when you're praying. Oh, my goodness. So I come back with the money, hand him the money. He's about to start to cry. His name's Charles the Mechanic. That's what I call him. He reaches out. I start telling about God has a plan for you. He cares about you. He wants to help you. He's on your side. I just minister in God's love. If you don't know what to say, come on. Now you can minister God's love to people. Come on. You don't have to be like a preacher. Anybody can minister God's love. You don't have to be perfect either. He's like, and suddenly after, he just reaches out and hugs me with the big hairy chest. And I'm kind of like, I'm underdressed for the moment. You know what I'm saying? It was hairy chest on bare chest. Oh! But you know what, man? I hugged him. I didn't hesitate. He shook my hand. I didn't. You listening? How many pretty boys would have hesitated and he wouldn't have listened to him because he wouldn't shake his hand? So I greased myself up real good. I even got some chest hair on me now. I had to borrow a little bit of that, man. Let's go on before we get in trouble. As I finish this message right now, how to be a kingdom servant. Three things real quick, and I'm done. How to be a kingdom servant. Number one, you must decide that I'm going to be a servant to people around me and have that heart. I'm going to be committed, solid, and no turning back. Number two, find a place to serve here or anywhere, wherever God puts on your heart to serve, but serve people somewhere. Number three, be faithful in your position. God has called, be faithful. Don't just do something for a couple weeks. Give it time. Root yourself. You grow when you root yourself, right? And in closing today, I would like to just talk about eternity for a moment, all right? Because I don't like to go through a service without an altar call. I try not to. And I'd like to take a moment and reflect on eternity. Now, what's eternity mean? Eternity is the end of, eternity is forever. It's there is no end to this. It's hard for a human being that has been born. And you've been alive how long? Oh, do you mind if I ask that? 22? Oh, 30 years. So yeah, I guess low. 30 years. A 30-year-old talking to a billion, quadrillion, trillion, 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 quadrillion, trillion, times quadrillion, trillion, trillion, trillion-year-old God. Our mind is finite. God's mind is infinite. When it comes to eternity, we know here, just like my dog Buddy, all he knows is the sunroom. Mama won't let him out. She's like the Gestapo. You will not get out of here right now. You will poop on the couch. No. So he has to stay in his little space. The earth is your space, but one day you're going to be out of this place. And you're going to be in another place, baby. I've seen the rapture. God showed me the rapture in a dream vision. Jesus actually appeared to me at the same time I had the dream vision of the rapture. And let me tell you what, it's soon. Jesus is coming. Are you ready for the return of the Lord Jesus Christ? If he came today, would you go? Well, if you know Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're serving him, you're living for him. Hey, you're going up when that trumpet sounds. And there is a judgment for us Christians. Well, we will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And he will find out if you, you will find out for sure that day. I never was supposed to be a lawyer. I was supposed to be a doctor. God has the plan. Don't run from it. Run to it. I said, don't run from his plan. Run to it. I want to read this scripture. I saw a great white throne. Now, this is not the judgment the Christians will experience. This is the judgment the non-believer will experience. And I saw a great white throne and the one sitting on it, God, Father. The other judgment's the judgment seat of Christ, okay? Of Christ. The earth and sky fled from his presence, and they found no place to hide. Verse 12, I saw the dead, both great and small. On that day, it doesn't matter if you had your doctorate. That doctorate won't mean anything that day, if you know what I mean. We will be stripped bare before him. I mean the great white throne judgment, but the sinner will be also stripped bare during this judgment, called the great white throne judgment. And the books were opened, including the book of life. Everybody say book of life. And the dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in the books. So there's other books. Yeah? There's the book of life. There are books that record, right? It says, and the books were open, including the book of life, and the dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in the books. The sea gave up its dead, and the death and the grave gave up their dead. So everybody that's not born again will be standing before the throne of God, the great white throne judgment. And all were judged. Come on, I want to hear it. Everybody say, all were judged according to their deeds. Right there. Then death and the grave were thrown into the lake of fire. So God literally takes death in the grave and he throws them into the lake of fire, which is called the second death. Nobody wants to experience a second death. And anyone whose name was not found recorded in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Now, why am I saying that? Because I love people. And if you're here today, you've never received Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you're listening to me online in another country, as some other people in other countries may be listening, I just want to give you an opportunity to receive Christ in your heart. Know where you're going to spend eternity. The end will come for all of us. We will all die. It is appointed unto man once to die, and then there is the judgment. So right now, if you don't know Jesus, raise your hand. I want to pray for you. You can receive Christ today. Raise your hand up. Every head bowed. Please bow your head if you don't mind. That's just the way I like to do it, if you don't mind to bow your head. Raise your hand up if you need to pray today or receive Jesus. Raise your hand up. Let's wait a moment. Amen. I see it. Go ahead. Got it. Let's all pray together. And if you're watching online, as a church family, we like to pray together, don't we? Because we're celebrating people who receive Jesus. Let's all pray together and pray the prayer of salvation. Lord Jesus, come in my heart and be my Savior. I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you rose from the dead. Jesus, show me the plan you have for my life. Amen.
I just, more than anything, want to be obedient to God this morning, and I'm so moved right now towards some hearts. Some hearts that are in this room, some that are watching now, some that will watch. I'm moved towards your heart. Philippians 3:10 says, I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participate in his sufferings, becoming like him in death, and yet in participating in some of the sufferings that we've been through, we've allowed this heart to not be what we want it to be. And if you've been here very long, you know my story about cruising down 169 and going off of an exit ramp and just this moment I had with Jesus, I'm like, yuck, I don't like my heart. I don't like what I've allowed the world to make me become, and I'm done with that. And I'm opening up my heart again. I'm taking off that hard wall. I'm pulling down that wall, right? And I'm making room for what he wants me to be. And there's some in here today, and your heart, because of life, has gotten a little bit hard because of experience. And in your flight or fight response, you've allowed this wall to come up, and you know it's not you, because God cares about your heart. And if there's anything the enemy comes for in life, it's our heart. And we're going to return. We're going to sing this Make Room for God song again. What's the name of the song? Is it Make Room for God? And we're going to do it right now. And so if you have had it any way, your heart be challenged to get hard, I want you to stand up. I'm standing. Anyone else want to stand with me? Life's tried to harden your heart. Anybody else want to stand with us? Well, Father, right now we just lift these hearts up before you. We say, this heart's not mine, God, it's yours. And we ask by your Spirit, by you who lives in us, that by the great physician, that you heal broken, hurt hearts, and that restoration comes, Father, that we know how to be wise with our lives, but not shut off life, the life you intended us to live. And so I declare healing and peace and restoration right now in this place. And you say, how do I do it? How do I do it? How do I do it? Let's just sing this song. And as you do, you say, Father, I'm making room again. I'm making room. I'm making room. Tear down any wall you want to tear down. Anything I've allowed to be built up. I choose today to make room for you.